everyone. I would like to welcome you to the Q3 FY21 earnings call of Engineers India. The management today is being represented by Mr. Sunil Bhatia, Director of Finance, Mr. Suvendu Padhi, Company Secretary, Mr. R.P. Batra, Group General Manager, Finance and Accounts and Investor Relations, and Mr. Vinay Kalia, Chief General Manager, Business Development and Investor Relations. I'll now hand over the call to Mr. Bhatia for his initial remarks, post which we'll open up the floor for Q&A. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon. I welcome everyone to the earnings call. I'll just brief you on the financial position of the company. During the 9 months period from April to December 20, we secured a business of 864 crore. And the order book as on 31st December 2020 was 8297 crore. For the quarter ended December 20, we achieved a total turnover of 837 crore, comprising of consultancy domestic of 267 crore, consultancy foreign 92 crore. So total consultancy was 358 crore and 478 crore was turnkey. The turnover as compared to corresponding period of previous year was lower by 6%, and as compared to the previous quarter of September 2020, it was higher by 22%. Business mix as on 31st December 2020 was consultancy 43% and turnkey 57%. For 9 months period ended December 2020, the total turnover achieved was 1988 crore, comprising of turnover domestic of 730 crore, turnover consultancy foreign of 249 crore. So,
you'll ring me when your phone is always busy, so I can talk.
Yeah. We are having earning calls, so So total consultancy of 979 crore and turnkey of 1009 crore. As compared to corresponding period of previous year, the turnover of 1988 crore is lower by 15% compared to turnover of 2349 crore achieved during corresponding period of previous year. You will recall that last year, the turnover of 2349 crore included one-time impact of change order of 97 crore. In case we compare on like-to-like basis, the turnover of last year was 2252 crore, and the decrease as against 15% gets reduced to 11.7%. We achieved the operating profit of 70 crore during the quarter ended December 2020. Almost at the same level of operating profit achieved during the previous quarter, September 2020, of 71 crore, and lower by around 10 crore as compared to operating profit achieved during December 19. Other income has reduced to 48 crore from 53 crore achieved during September 2020 and 66 crore achieved during corresponding period of previous year, mainly due to reduction in the interest rate on fixed deposits. Profit before tax achieved was 118 crore during December 20 quarter, compared to profit of 124 crore achieved during September 2020 and profit of 145 crore achieved during corresponding period of previous year. Profit after tax achieved was 88 crore compared to 93 crore achieved during September 2020 and 109 crore achieved during December 19. EPS on annualized basis was 1.39 rupees per share compared to 1.47 rupees per share during September 20 and 1.72 rupees during September 19. For 9 months period, operating profit achieved was 156 crore as compared to 314 crore achieved during corresponding period of previous year. 314 crore of operating profit included two one-time impact. One was 85 crore due to variation order, and impairment adjustment expenditure of around 26 crore, which we had accounted for in the corresponding period of previous year. In case it is offset, then the operating profit has reduced by 39% as compared to corresponding period of previous year. Operating margin achieved was 8% as compared to 11% achieved during corresponding period of previous year on like-to-like basis. Other income achieved was 151 crore as compared to 190 crore of corresponding period of previous year, mainly due to reduction in the interest rate on fixed deposits. And profit before tax of 307 crore compared to 503 crore. And profit after tax of 229 crore compared to 301 crore. EPS rupees 3.62 rupees per share compared to rupees 4.76 per share. Segment results. The segment profit we achieved on consultancy and engineering project of 91 crore as against 93 crore achieved during September 20 and 90 crore achieved during December 19. Turnkey project segment profit remains at almost at the same level as compared to September quarter. We achieved a turnkey segment profit of 6.51 crore compared to 6.27 crore achieved during September 20. And the segment profit on turnkey achieved was 15.96 during corresponding period of previous year. Capital employed as on 31st December 2020 was 2463 crore compared to 2380 crore as on September 2020 and 2510 crore as on December 19. As you all know that the buyback process is on. The offer got opened on 22nd of January and it will close on 5th of February. Buyback offer comprises of shares not exceeding 6,98,69,047 fully paid up equity shares at a buyback price of rupees 84 per equity share for an aggregate consideration not exceeding rupees 586.90 crore through tender route under stock exchange mechanism. I would also like to inform you on the development with respect to our joint venture company, RFCL. The commissioning of the RFCL project was targeted during December 2020, but because of some equipment-related problem in the CPP plant being executed by BHEL, the commissioning got delayed. The problem has been rectified, and the commissioning activities are on, and now we are targeting commissioning of the project in February 2021. Now the house is open for queries from your side.
Thank you very much. We will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Arfat Sayed from Reliance Securities. Please go ahead.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Sayyar, your line is unmuted. Please go ahead with your question.
Hello, I'm audible?
Yes.
Yeah, so I want to understand your project pipeline for next 2 years and what kind of project you're looking for next 2 years and also order inflow guidance for 2022 and 2023.
We have already shared in the past that we have 2 committed orders, one from Indian Oil for the Panipat refinery expansion and one for the Petro HCC and PP project of BPCL. Both these projects are under phase 1 and phase 2 of execution. The main project execution for both the projects are being targeted by next year. They were being targeted earlier in this year, but because of the COVID impact, there have been delays. Plus, clients are also looking at the optimization of cost and reconfiguration activities, which we are already doing in phase 1. So the phase 2 activities of both these projects are targeted for next year, by middle of next year. Panipat refinery, the main project execution would be in the range of 600 crores. And BPCL refinery project would be in the range of 200 crores. We are also looking for a new refinery at Kaveri Basin at Nagapattinam for Indian Oil. Indian Oil, during the news, have already announced CAPEX approval for this refinery. The bidding process is already been initiated by CPCL, and we expect some orders to come through by the end of this year or beginning of next year. So this is another project that we are targeting by end of this year or next year. It's still under bidding process, so values will be known in due course once the bids are announced. Subsequently, we are looking for some more projects in next year only, after the second half, the Mangalore refinery expansion project, for which the feasibility study has already been done. We are also looking at one or two small projects this year also from Numaligarh, which could materialize by the end of this quarter for the revamp and quality upgrade in Numaligarh refinery. We can also look at HMEL expansion next year, which is a cracker expansion from 1.2 to 1.5 MMTPA. The cracker project is currently ongoing for 1.2 MMTPA, and subsequent expansion is also being planned by HMEL in next year. So these are large ticket value orders, and there are some small pipeline orders from pipeline segment, from LPG segment, and from the strategic reserves and LPG caverns that we are expecting to come up in next year also. So going forward, as of now, since we are coming out of COVID and project CAPEX in announcements are gradually taking shape again, we feel the targets for next year could be in the range of 1500 to 2000 crores, but the numbers would be finalized as and when the CAPEX plans get concluded by the OMC. There have been some delays because of COVID and because of the shortfalls in the cash flows in the oil companies. So it will take some time for us to freeze out the targets for the next year.
Okay. That's it, my friend. Thanks, sir.
Thank you. We would like to remind participants that you may press star 1 to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Varun Patni from Press Pro Tree. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Thank you for the opportunity. As you mentioned, the ISE and BPCL have been postponed to the next year. What would be the guidance for the current year FY21, given that we have already secured business of 863 crores? So how much of it, there's any more steam left for the next quarter?
We are expecting one order from Numaligarh refinery in this year of the order of about 100 crores. that can materialize within a month or so. We are expecting the opening of tenders for the Kaveri Basin Refinery. The bids have been submitted. We are expecting some announcements from Kaveri Basin. If those announcements are made, because now the CAPEX investments have also been approved by the Indian Oil Board, we can expect another big order in this year also.
Right. But the bidding process is yet to be done for that.
Bidding process has been done. The bids have been submitted. They are under evaluation. They can open at any time now.
Okay. Thank you. That was helpful. Another question I had was with respect to the order execution. So from the consolidated profit and loss statement, we could see that the execution has been 358 crores for this consultancy. And if we look at the order book, then if we add opening and the business secured less the closing, the figure comes to 383 crores. So what about the difference of 25 crores? If you could explain something about that.
Yeah, basically, this is a sort of adjustment. There are certain reduction and addition in the scope of work over a period of time. So these type of reduction and addition take place. The difference is only on account of the basically some reduction in the scope of work for the some contracts.
Okay, right. So this is not happening first time. This happens on a
consistent. This is a normal practice. Sometimes you find increase, sometimes you find decrease.
Right, correct. And so with respect to the NRL, if you have some kind of update with respect to that.
You are talking about the order that we are going to secure?
No. The divestment of BPCL and NRL.
See, we'll be informing at the appropriate time. As I said in our last meeting also, that not many things are taking place simultaneously. As you know, that our buyback offer is there, then due diligence process has to get completed. Then whatever valuation is finally worked out, based on all these factors and our kitty, we'll be taking a considered view that whether we intend to go for taking equity stake in NRL or not, and if yes, to what extent. So as of now, it is too early to say anything on that. Once the total process gets completed, only then we'll be in a position to comment on that.
Okay, thank you. With respect to RFCL, sir, we could expect the revenues coming in from February and March this year, or it would be taking on from next fiscal.
We are targeting to declare commercial operation date by February end of sometime in March. So a very marginal part will come in the current financial year, and otherwise it will go to the next financial year.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah, that was helpful.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Samarth Singh from TPF Capital. Please go ahead.
Yes, good afternoon. Thanks for the opportunity. My question was on RFCL. Do we have any plans for a separate listing of RFCL in the future?
Not now, because I think that decision will be taken by RFCL board, as per my understanding, after the total debt is paid off, or major chunk of the debt has been paid off. So it will, it will be taken in due course of time. Once the plant gets stabilized and it is into 1 or 2 years of operation, only then the board will give some consideration to this.
Okay. Given that gas prices are at historical lows and reduced subsidies due from the government, and a combination of that with, liquid equity markets, I think fertilizer companies are getting a great valuation today. So, perhaps we should think of not waiting for the debt pay down and doing a listing and taking some money off the table today itself. This is just a suggestion. It does a couple of things. It will help us get a good valuation for our investment. It will help us take some money off the table, and it will also prove to the markets that, you know, Engineers India management is very capable at investing in ancillary businesses and creating value for shareholders.
See, your suggestion is appropriate for existing urea units where the different policy governs them. As far as these new projects are concerned, they are governed by a separate new investment policy in which gas price is a pass-through. So it doesn't, the price of gas doesn't impact the profitability of the company. In case the gas price is low, the concession price to be given by government also comes on the lower side. So a better proposition as far as we understand would be that once the plant gets stabilized, and also I would like to share with you that since government borrows beyond 100% capacity utilization to meet the urea deficit in the country, in case that happens in future, once all the revival project and new projects are into commercial operation, then government may resort to buying on merit order basis. And RFCL's cost of production, variable cost, would be amongst the lowest. So they will be in a better position to sell beyond 100% to the government. But those things will get stabilized only after 1 or 2 years of operation, and once the all new plants are there, that should be the period when RFCL should venture into the market, and that decision in any case will be given a due consideration by the RFCL board at an appropriate time.
Okay, thanks. And could you just give me on the balance sheet the cash, debt, and the customer advances, please?
For EIL? Sorry? For EIL? Are you asking for EIL for RFCL?
For EIL.
The cash is around 2,500 crore, and there is no debt on the company balance sheet.
And the customer advances?
Customer advances are around 100, cash advances are around 100 to 150 crore.
Okay. And the last question from my side, I read somewhere that you know, the government is coming up with new targets for PSUs where you know, the rating is decided based on return on equity and market value, etc. So has that happened, and does that apply to EIL as well?
No, those parameters have not yet been firmed up by the government. So the evaluation and MOU rating is presently based on the existing parameters.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Viral Shah from Prabhudas Lilladher. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, sir. Hello, can you hear me?
Good evening. Yeah, good evening. Please. Good evening.
Yeah, sir, what has been the reason for our margins being lower for the turnkey business? Because if you look at last 3-4 quarters, we are in the range of around 1.9 to 1.4%. And we have been guiding around 3 to 4% kind of EBITDA margin. So what has led to that? Is it only the top line, or there is something else as well?
You are talking about the turnkey segment?
Turnkey segment, sir.
Yeah, turnkey segment, you see, basically, right now we are executing the jobs which are cost plus jobs. So those jobs are basically negotiated at a fee on our plant and machinery. So whatever the expenditure is being incurred, on that we are getting a certain amount of percentage as a fee. Over a period of time, during the last few years, the fees negotiated with the client are in the range of around 3 to 5% that we are basically giving to you also. So taking into consideration that our margins are in the range of around 3%. Just you see the December 19 quarter, our margin was 3%. At that time, we were executing certain LSTK jobs also. So we had written certain provisions due to the completion of that particular job. Right now, we are majorly executing two jobs. One is the Rajasthan refinery project, and another is the HPCL VRMP project. So these are cost plus project, and the margins are being basically we have got the job under a strict you say competitive prices. So we are also providing certain provisions for these jobs, including the guarantee and warranty liability. So as and when those projects will be completed, we might get released certain provisions, and as such margins may increase in that particular quarter or year. Going forward, taking into consideration our present order book, we are expecting the margin to vary between around 3% maximum, and minimum will be 2%, something like that.
Fair enough, sir. Sir, so is the understanding correct that you would have bidded for around 3 to 5% kind of margin, but you have made a provisioning of roughly 1%. So once the provisioning got released, then at that quarter or that financial year per se, the margins will be substantially higher. Is the understanding?
Yeah,
correct?
You are very right. In case no liability comes, definitely there will be written back the provision, and the margin to that extent will increase during that particular quarter or year.
See, for any turnkey project, the clear position emerges only when the contract gets closed.
Yeah.
So during execution, in terms of accounting standards, we keep some provisions, and once the contract is finally settled and closed, then the clear position will emerge.
No, I agree to it, sir. So, okay, got it, sir. And sir, that is also the main reason, because your contribution of turnkey business has been substantial during the quarter. And that is the main reason why your EBITDA margin on console level would have come down, right? Is the understanding correct, or there is some?
Yeah, your understanding is correct. Yes, definitely. Yeah,
correct. Sir, what is the status? Second question is, what is the status of our bid which we were supposed to bid for HPCL with IOC on HPCL refinery? Any update on that?
Could you repeat your question, sir? We could not hear.
Sir, we were supposed to put a bid with Indian Oil IOC, right, for bidding for the BPCL refinery. Any update on that, a strategic bid which we were supposed to put on?
We have bid for the Kaveri Basin Refinery of Indian Oil. It is CPCL refinery, which is
okay.
It's a Indian Oil Group company. The bids have already been submitted about 2-3 months ago, and meanwhile CPCL was going for internal approvals for the CAPEX. Finally, the Indian Oil Board has announced the CAPEX investment for Kaveri Basin, and now we feel the bids would be opened soon.
And do you know how many participants would be there for the bid? 2-3 or?
There are three bidders at least in the bids that CPCL have floated.
Fair enough, sir. Sir, apart from the pipeline which you would have announced, and how is the projects which are looking globally? Could you touch upon the export market and the opportunities which might come up there as well? That would be helpful.
Export markets will still be sluggish because, you know, they are crude exporting nations. They are dependent upon crude inventories for more revenues. So with the fall in crude prices, they have cut down a lot of their CAPEX plans. They are looking at revamp and quality upgrade projects, energy efficiency improvement projects, value maximization projects, which are of small size. So we are not looking at large projects from their side. We might be looking at small annual rate contracts coming up from Middle East.
Okay, fair enough. That's really helpful. That's it from my side. Thank you, and all the rest.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Saket Kapoor from Kapoor Company. Please go ahead.
Dhanyavaad, sir, for the opportunity. Sir, on this Barmer refinery part, sir, there are expansion expected there also. So, what is the update on that? What scope of work are we eyeing in this refinery?
See, we are already executing the Barmer refinery. This is an integrated refinery with a petrochemical complex. We are both the consultants for this refinery, plus one of the projects has been given on a cost plus basis, which is a turnkey segment. So currently that project is under execution as of now, and we are the main consultants for the same. Some more small value assignments could come in from their expansion of marketing terminal and some value additions in the existing refinery if they feel like. But yes, the larger CAPEX is already committed and we are executing that.
And so where are we in this stage of completion? Meaning how much have been spent on the project and when it will be nearing completion?
See, the OBE contract or the cost plus contract is about 30% complete. And the consultancy contract for the main refinery and petrochemical complex is around 20% complete. Major EPC, lot of EPC packages have been already awarded, and some more packages are yet to be awarded in the refinery complex.
Mm-hmm.
So sooner or later, you will see the execution of main EPC phase in the refinery.
And the total cost of the project, sir, that we are handling, the scope
cost
of work is
that we are handling is around 45,000 to 48,000 crores, but it is expected to increase further because CAPEX is being re-estimated as and when the EPC contracts get awarded. The CAPEX numbers keep on changing.
Okay. And only 30% and 20% is what has been executed. So there is a lot of revenue that is going to come from the, as and when the project.
Basically, we are executing two jobs. One is as a PMC, that is around 1182 crores, and another is basically OB job, where the contract price is around 3700 crores. So these two jobs basically we are executing.
Okay.
So this is the CAPEX which I was sharing with you, around 45,000 to 48,000.
Okay. Right. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Your question.
Did I got disconnected, ma'am?
No, sir. Your question is answered, sir.
One more question I want to ask. I can continue.
Yes, sir. You may go ahead.
Yes. Regarding, sir, this buyback part of the story, sir, which is continuing right now. Sir, what is the government of India share, sir, in this? You must have consulted them, sir. Out of the total, I think so, 686 you precisely mentioned. Well, what would be the tendering ratio from acceptance from the government side? How much?
Government of India is currently is holding 51.49% in EEL. While participating in the tender, they participate while giving their consent. They have given a condition that they will retain 51% holding in EIL.
Okay, post the issue, it will be 51% for them.
Yes.
So, sir, that is what I'm. What is the calculation you have done, sir? How much is the tendering that is going to come from them?
It will depend on the participation by other shareholders till the closing date. So I think government will be tendering during that time only, after seeing what is the percentage or number of shares tendered by other shareholders.
Right.
Government intent is clear that they don't want to go below 51%.
They don't want to go below 51%. And sir, looking at now the RFPL project also coming on stream, and the cash we are generating and the cash which we have on the balance sheet.
So this is the operator. There is a disturbance coming from your line from the background. I would request you to mute your line once the management answers your question.
Absolutely, ma'am. Let me complete now, ma'am. Sir, I was talking about the cash flows which are generated for this quarter. Sir, can you give the idea, sir? What have been the cash flow for this quarter, sir?
Yeah, basically cash flow, whatever the profit is there, that is basically more or less is the cash flow generated during the current quarter. Plus, we have the made the payment of the dividend also during the
October
in the month of October. So considering that, our cash flow as of date is around we are having a cash and bank balance of around 2500 crore.
Okay, and there are no receivables, sir. I wanted to understand how much, what is the receivables for the 9 months?
Yeah, receivables are, net receivables are around 550 crore.
554. And sir, going forward, the cash which will be generated post this buyback, what kind of dividend payout could we expect? Next, we will be coming up with the annual numbers. And how is quarter four shaping up, sir, in terms of the execution cycle? Where are we going to likely end this year, as you must have done the homework for that?
The quarter four execution we are seeing will be much improved as compared to previous quarters. And as you rightly said that once the buyback is completed, and then we'll work out the dividend part. And you must have seen previously also that during last couple of years, there has been intent to maximize the dividend, and that intent will carry on. But it's too early to say, to comment anything on the quantum of dividend which we are seeing, which we may target.
Right, sir. And lastly, sir, in today's union budget, the figure of 34.5 lakh crore capital expenditure, capital outflow has been mentioned in terms of the capex. So, looking at that in the segment which we operate, what...
Mr. Kapoor, sir, this is the operator. I would request you to rejoin the queue for follow-up.
Absolutely, ma'am. Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Reminder to the participants, anyone who wishes to ask a question may please press star and one at this time. The next question is from the line of Jonas Gutta from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Good evening, sir, and thank you for the opportunity. Firstly, on a bookkeeping question, sir, I just missed out on the numbers that you just gave the earlier participant on the Barmer project completion. So how much of that is still pending in our consultancy backlog, and how much of that in the turnkey backlog, if you can give that separately?
Yeah, I was giving the overall perspective of the CAPEX investments and how the progress on the project has happened. So overall progress on the project is about 20% to 25%. That's on the CAPEX side. While the services progress numbers for our revenue recognition would be different.
Right. So you, as part of a backlog, you wouldn't have completed 20%. You would have completed slightly higher, right? Or because that is on physical, sorry, so that is on physical completion, so it should be lower. How should one look at that?
We have completed about similar range only. We are also quite close to that.
Almost at the same level.
Yeah, almost at the same level.
So we have also closed about 20%.
Okay.
Yeah, in the consultancy, the contract price was 1182. So in the order book, it's around 900 crore.
And on the turnkey side, sir? Hello.
So the line for the management is disconnected. Kindly stay on line till I reconnect them.
Sure.
gentlemen, we have the management reconnected to the call. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Yes, sir. So you were mentioning the turnkey portion, sir. How much of the Barmer project is?
Yeah, basically around 20% we have executed. If you go by the contract price,
okay.
So we have recognized to the extent of around 20%, both in the consultancy and the turnkey segment.
Okay. So my second question was, when you mentioned the initial target for FY22 in terms of order flows, which is about 1,500 to 2,000 crores. Just wanted to reconfirm that out of this, 800 crores, which is Panipat and Rasayani, form part of that number?
Yes.
So, and if you expect Kaveri Basin and Mangalore to flow through in FY22, do you believe that the Kaveri Basin order also will be broken up into phases, and that is why this order inflow number sort of looks muted?
We are expecting Kaveri Basin in this this year itself, if now that Indian Oil has announced the CAPEX plans, they can come up in this year. Yes, there are multiple tendering in CPCL project also. So some of this can come up in this year at least.
So last, when you know, you had mentioned the total opportunity out of Kaveri Basin was anywhere close to 800 to 1,000 crores,
yeah,
you know, for the 9 million ton refinery. So
yes,
the one that the package that you're targeting in the fourth quarter will be somewhere in the 300 to 400 crores.
It's competitive bidding and there are multiple players. So
okay,
which one we get, let's see, and how much.
Okay. Okay. So it's not certain that if you get one package, you'll get the other, just like what happened in Numaali.
So on the case, but yes, few packages are big, few are small, so we have to see. So we are hopeful of getting one package, at least a big package.
And my last question was, sir, you mentioned that, you know, we've made some conservative provisions in the turnkey segment, which is why our margins for the 9 months are hovering around 1.5-1.6%. Could you quantify these provisions? I know they are in the normal scheme of things and there's nothing extraordinary, but just to give us
those are being disclosed in our financial statement also, basically on what basis we are making the provision. For the turnkey project, we are making the provision on account of guarantee at the rate of 1% of the value executed. So these provisions are accumulated over a period of the contract. So when the contract is completed, in case no liability comes on account of the guarantee and warranty liability, those are returned back at that point of time. So during the currency of the contract, 1% of the provision is being accumulated, and those are returned back when the contract is complete. Plus, there are certain other provisions also, like in the turnkey segment also, we have executed certain LSTK project. There are certain outstanding are there. So as per the Ind AS, we have to make a provision based on the pendency of that particular contract. So those provision also comes into force during the turnkey segment as well as the consultancy segment. So principally, there are two major provisions. One is on account of the guarantee and warranty liability, and another is the provision for the doubtful debts. So you just see our track record. Normally, we don't encounter any sort of write-off on account of debts. So only the time gap is here. So during the currency of the project, these things are accumulated, and once on the completion of the contract, these are resolved, they are returned back. So that add up to the profit for that particular quarter or the financial year.
Got it, sir. Thank you. All the very best, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin Gandhi from KIFS Trade Capital. Please go ahead. Mr. Gandhi, your line
Thanks. Yeah, thanks for taking my question. So, continuing the previous question, can you tell us what is the cumulative provision as on 31st, previous quarter ended for a turnkey?
That I have to check up basically. I don't have right now that provision available with me right now.
Okay. Maybe can I get through email subsequently?
Yeah, we can communicate, yes. You can talk to me and
Sure. Thank you. The next question is, considering the earnings volatility during a tough time, are you likely to see the dividend stable dividend policy at least? Because, or is there any constraint for making total payout as a percentage of the profit on during the year, for which is stipulated internally, so that we can reach some figure, some color on that dividend policy?
As I told you, the things will get firmed up only when the offer for buyback is closed. Only then we'll come to know of the total amount which is going towards buyback and the total amount which is available to us. So I think that point of time...
Let's assume it's going to be 100%. 2500 crore you have cash is there, 600 crore will go for the buyback. Then you'll be left with 1900 and maybe you'll add 120 for the quarter four.
Yes, yeah, in that scenario, we'll estimate the total profitability for the current financial year by estimating the quarter four number, and then we'll see how much we can pay as dividend, because we need to also see that the cash availability with us for undertaking our normal operations of the business.
So, what is the normal requirement for the CapEx?
Normal requirement for current year is around 75 crore.
And considering the projects what we have on hand for next year, FY22, what do you expect this to be?
Next year, we are targeting a capex of around 130 crore, which also includes some part of the building renovation of our office.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much, and expect that at least stable dividend is made. That's the at least what we wish for. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Participants, to ask a question, you may press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Ketan Shah from CapGrow Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I have one question on the Numaligarh refinery. Sir, along with Oil India, we have submitted a bid. So, can you update us how much will be our investments if we win the bid?
See, we have submitted expression of interest along with Oil India, and it was also informed that we may go in for minority stakeholding. But everything clarity will emerge only when the total due diligence exercise gets completed, valuation is firmed up. So it's too early to say anything on that, because one is that whether to go for equity participation or not, that will depend on due diligence, completion of due diligence exercise. Once that decision is taken that, okay, we are based on our commercial interest, we intend to have equity participation in NRL, then the quantum will depend upon the valuation and the kitty available with us after the buyback.
Sir, is it right for me to say that it will be a very substantial cash outflow from our side, because we will have 2500 of crores of cash which we have, and Numaligarh, if we are able to get, then substantial cash which we have in our balance sheet will go towards that, or what is the thought process, or are we having any limit to which we will be able to spend such kind of money?
See, with respect to limit, the board of directors of the company of Navratna status, they are empowered to invest in joint venture up to 15% of net worth of or 1000 crore, whichever is lower.
Okay. I understood. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin Gandhi from KFS Trade Capital. Please go ahead.
afternoon. Yeah, thanks for taking my question again. So last year you had quarter three versus quarter four certain volatility in terms of revenue as well as the profitability. So is there something lumpiness, or can you guide something for the Q4 execution, considering we have already passed to 1 month, and do you see any disturbing trend, or you think that it could be another normal quarter?
Q4 we are expecting a normal quarter. In the last financial year, in Q1, there was a change order from the Dangote refinery that had basically contributed to the additional revenue and profit in that particular financial year. Otherwise, during the current financial year, we are expecting the Q4 to be a normal one.
So that will be similar to what at least we had last year, right? YOY it will be better.
Yeah, more or less it will be in line with that. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Neerav, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Thanks for giving me the opportunity. Sir, I'm referring to slide number 8. And on that slide, actually, I see that the segment profit for the turnkey segment is consistently going down from 28% in FY 16-17 to just 1% in Q3 2021. So I want to know, are we pricing this contract too aggressively? And what is the reason for such a sharp decline in the operating profit or the segment profit for the turnkey project? That is my first question.
Yeah, in the earlier years, basically, we were executing the petrochemical projects. In those projects, there was a substantial margin. Those were the very complex projects. So margin were definitely higher than the project currently we are executing. So you are talking about 28% profit. That may be one of the case. In that particular quarter, we may have written back the certain provisions we had created during the previous years. That may be the reason for the 28% margin, what you are saying. Otherwise, definitely during those periods, we were earning the profit, segment profit of around 7 to 10%. Right now, whatever turnkey project we are executing, these are very simple one projects, basically offsite utility projects. So in these projects, basically the margins are very less in comparison to the complex petrochemical plants which we had executed for MRPL during those periods. So that is the principally the reason for decline in the margin in the turnkey segment.
Okay, thanks a lot for your response. Sir, in that case, can we follow the strategy of executing more consulting work and moving away from the turnkey, because our margin in consulting segment is consistently about 25% or more? So doesn't it make sense to focus more on the consulting segment and get a better return on capital rather than focusing on the turnkey segment where our margin is just 1% right now? And even it was in a single digit for most of the period in past few years.
Yeah, that depends basically on the client. In case client want to execute certain project in the turnkey segment, the major difference between the turnkey project and consultancy project is basically in the turnkey project, the my revenue and expenditure includes the plant and machinery cost. So in case you compare with the whatever efforts I am making, even 2-3% profit is substantial in comparison to the turnkey consultancy segment, where my principal cost is the employee cost. So I don't have a choice basically. In case client wants to execute a particular project in the on turnkey basis, I have to secure a business. I have to deploy my workforce. So depending on the client's choice, definitely our first preference will be the consultancy. But in case client insists for the turnkey segment, we go for that.
See, we are not executing turnkey by compromising with consultancy segment. This is the additional business which we take based on decision of the client.
and the exact profitability from turnkey gets established only when the contract gets completed. So the example which you were giving, that in one quarter it was 28%, so that may be due to the reason that one of the LSTK contract got completed during that quarter. So each and every turnkey contract is taken on its own merit and as an additional business to our consultancy segment.
Thanks a lot, sir. Just my final point on this one, sir. In that case, could we price the turnkey contract more aggressively? Because I think you mentioned earlier that typically we keep the margin of 2-3% for the turnkey contract. And clearly, based on the result, what we see, that doesn't seem to be enough for the kind of risk which we take in executing those contracts. So could we then kind of price the contract more aggressively so that we can actually get the better return on our capital and effort and the risk which we take?
See, the pricing is already done by taking into consideration all those factors, so that we, once the contract gets closed, we should earn up a reasonable margin on the execution of the contract by safeguarding our interest. That point is well taken while we bid for any turnkey contract.
Sir, in that case, just a final point. In that case, could we assume the lower single digit as a profit margin for your turnkey segment and 25% plus for the consultancy segment? That would be the ongoing run rate for two of these businesses?
Yes.
Yeah, based on the current order book position, definitely in the consultancy segment between 25% to 27%, and in the turnkey segment around 2-3%.
Okay, thanks a lot, sir. Appreciate it.
Further, I would like to say that to de-risk, there are other strategies. For example, all these are cost-plus contracts. And these are utility and off-site contracts. They are not the petrochemical refineries and petrochemical plants where the risk is more. And since it is a cost-plus contract, all the plant and machinery cost is a pass-through cost, unlike a price contract. So while we do pricing and the profitability, we check into the account whether it is whether we can de-risk from other modes of contracting or not.
Okay, thank you a lot, sir. This was really helpful. Appreciate it.
Thank you. As there are no further questions, I would now like to hand the conference over to Ms. Bhumika Nair from DM Capital Advisors Limited for closing comments.
Yes, sir. Would like to thank you for giving us an opportunity to host the call, and many thanks for all the participants for being there. Thank you very much, sir, for answering all the queries. Wishing you all the very best.
Thank you, Bhumika. Thank you so much.
Thank you.